I'm Peter Brown from Tiny & Sons Glass. Tiny & Sons Glass was established in 1978 with my father and brother and I. We're at 575 Washington Street in Pembroke. We're certified and qualified to do all your windshield replacement and repair. Tiny & Sons Glass is a community-based business. We have 12 mobile vans that come to you. If the weather's bad, you can come here to the shop. We have a nice waiting area, TV, Wi-Fi, kid-friendly, pet-friendly. We also can move about 15, 20 cars a day through the shop. Perfect for you when the weather's bad. So come on down to Tiny & Sons Glass if you need your windshield replaced or repaired. Tiny & Sons Glass, 1-888-64-TINIES. Just call. Thank you.
I'm Arthur Boyle of Performance Appraisal Services. We're residential real estate appraisers with a company founded in 1994 by Mike Gianelli and I in the basement of my house in Malden. We've since grown to have offices in Malden and Pembroke. We serve the eastern Mass counties, including Cape Cod. A good client for us is an attorney or a private landowner or a private property owner who's going through a probate process or a divorce division of property. Call us at 781-293-6900. Ask for Arthur Boyle or Amanda Boyle Grazioso. Our first name is Performance.
Or anything they'd like.
Given that you have far more experience and exposure, and not even looking for a guesstimate, just...
couldn't even ballpark it. One, this site is so unique and has so many different respondents looking at this site based on its location. I couldn't even begin to tell you when the state might make a response to this. The site's too unique. It's too different.
It's state.
They could have a response in 3 months or a year, and neither time frame would surprise me.
Neither one would surprise you, 3 months or a year.
Yeah.
Okay. Well, we can talk about that.
I guarantee you, given the citizen level of involvement on the Water Street project, we will probably be talking about it for some time. Thank you, Mr. Fine, for going out and being boots in the street and seeing what it actually all looks like. Kudos to you, so you can speak that much more knowledgeably to the topic, because it will be coming up over and over again. Obviously, there's some very concerned residents about this issue, and we will need to stay in front of it.
Okay.
Yeah. It was nice to go and meet some of the residents. It was good to take the walk through. I mean, it was thorny is an understatement. Mm-hmm. I mean, I destroyed my dress pants.
Yeah.
Yes,
next time,
sure,
wear jeans and tuck them in your boots, and you can get away.
But it was good to go. It was good to go.
All right, the other thing I want to just ask correspondence is we do have a letter that came from the Commonwealth of Massachusetts from the Food Protection or the Department of Public Health and the Food Protection Program. This is a letter that we all have. I would like to see if we can sum this up, the three paragraphs. Lisa, can you add any insight into this?
I can. Basically, the state is saying we stand by what we have written in our regulations. But to follow that up, I was really flattered that Diane Berzani reached out to me. And Diane is a member of DPH who actually sits on the Food Protection Advisory Program. And this group, and I'm going to kill the name here, it has a Food Establishment Advisory Committee, better known as FEAC, because the state loves acronyms, as we all know. I was very flattered. She asked me to come to their next meeting in April. She asked me to bring some information about this particular discussion. She thought it was a discussion that would benefit her group to discuss my particular situation. I was very flattered. I talked with her for a little bit. I'm providing her some of my documentation on my training, and as well as a letter from Nancy Funder saying the training I did with her. And to be able to be invited to be sitting in on a group like this, sit on a meeting like this, it's made up of Mass Restaurant Association, MIHA, MHOA. There's many health interest groups that sit on this board. So I'm very excited to go and very excited to see exactly how they come up. When you talk about food regulations in Massachusetts, these are the people that wrote the book. These are people that literally came up with this. So I'm very excited to sit down.
So Town of Pembroke, health.
I don't think I'll be sitting on it. I'm just lucky enough to sit and talk.
But
to them.
It sounds like we're going to be a case study. So
it does sound interesting.
A case study.
Well, we're going to try. It's going to be discussed at that meeting. So I'm excited for that.
But these are the people who write
they literally write the book.
They write the book. So I would think that their...
I'm looking forward to it very much.
Yeah. I would think that their definition or their findings will basically put this food inspection...
I had a very positive conversation with her. She's very excited about that.
Perfect. A
couple of comments, Madam Chair.
Sure, Mr. Fine.
Lisa.
Yes.
The person Michael Moore directed, does he work with... and that woman's name, I can never hang on to it.
That's her boss. That's Brandy's boss at the Food Protection Program. Brandy,
so
of course, we've...
Brandy reports to Michael.
Correct.
Okay. So when you talk, Madam Chair, about putting this issue to rest, and I'm looking at this for the first time, I definitely want to step back and read it in detail, but the last sentence in the second paragraph, each Board of Health is responsible for the administration and the enforcement. And the enforcement of the food code, and the boards are responsible for the actions of their agents. So, you know, in some respects, again, I haven't read the thing in great detail, but in some respects, they're pushing down to the board for be able
very
to.
Very much so. Absolutely.
So this is great.
Yep, very much so. And furthermore, I remind the board of this often, but if I may, I'll remind the board again. We go with the state regulations up till the point the board decides to do something else. You may not choose to be less stringent than the state regulations, but if the board feels, for whatever reason, you want to do more inspections or more detailed inspections, or you'd like to add further restrictions for whatever reasons about food handling or anything else, the board can vote to do so.
Mm-hmm.
The board can have in the town of Pembroke different regulations as long as they are not more lax than the state regulations. So if this board is interested in making something more stringent than the current state guidelines, by all means, and that's what they're saying, it's your program.
Mm-hmm.
If you want to make it more stringent than this, that's up to you.
Great. Well, I look forward to feedback from that.
I'm very much interested in seeing what they cover.
I hope that they're going to be totally impressed.
The genesis of this letter was maybe based on some of the queries of...
Yes, I would suspect so.
Yeah.
Okay.
Because it goes in that letter, it actually goes into the many inquiries or multiple requests for guidance from the Pembroke Board of Health relative to Chapter 10.
Which is an incorrect statement. There were not multiple, I shouldn't say that. My feeling was there weren't multiple requests from the Pembroke Board of Health. There were...
From health, I think there were, I definitely reached out to the state directly. We have an email on record. I went back with a second request because I wanted to clarify the fact that schools was not specifically called out, but I did not get a response. But I do know that from legal counsel that there have been numerous requests.
Well, two doesn't make for multiple. There must have been other requests.
I do not know what those are. So moving right along, we've got 3 minutes. Let's take the first one. The Pembroke establishment outbreaks. Lease update?
I've talked at length to, I got to grab his name. Here we go. Talked at huge length to Mark Bartlett. Mark Bartlett is the lead engineer for Stantec Engineering handling the rehab of the Pembroke Hospital septic facility. For now, there's no additional outbreak. For now, they're on a water management program, and for now, the treatment system on site is functioning. Think of it much like a Band-Aid that's not going to staunch much more blood. Mm-hmm. It can limp along for now, but we certainly don't want to stress this system. Mark has had the first of many series of meetings that he's going to be having with the DEP. The technical review is ongoing right now before DEP for March. They will do some borings and samples in April. They think that the assessment results in the preliminary application will be June. In August, they will have a formal submittal to DEP. We're going to be copied on all this as this goes along. Okay. He hopes that by November, mid-November, all the reviews are finalized. They then go to public notice, and they hope to have bids ready in February and be able to award one in March. The earliest installation on this new project would be April of 2018. Needless to say that Stantec, as well as the septic maintenance company on site, will be keeping a very, very, very close eye on it to make sure that there's no further surface outbreak. but at this point there's nothing else we can do. This is going to be because of the GPD gallons per day allotment. They're actually thinking about expanding the hospital. Whatever they do to solve this problem, it's going to be in the multi-millions of dollars. It's going to be a significant amount of money in engineering and permitting to get this all done with DEP. They want whatever they build to last the test of time and for any future use that Pembroke Hospital might have. So this is the time track we're on. So at this point, we're trying to keep the kettle on the stove without boiling over and monitor that as carefully as we can. Keep it on a low simmer. All right. The other establishment is moving forward. They've retained, young gentleman was in doing a file review for the field house. From Merrill and Associates, and they're beginning their preliminary work to get their project ongoing for the spring. Their project, while large, will not be anywhere near as large as that.
For Pembroke Hospital leases, we're talking 13 months before new installation.
Before a shovel on the ground, correct.
Big strong band-aid.
Concerns?
Only if we have further septic outbreak, which is being... To say it's highly monitored right now would be an understatement. The engineers and the septic monitors on site, the sewage treatment operators, the licensed guys on site are watching it very closely. So what they're doing is basically, of course, using their water as appropriately as they can so that they don't have that kind of a situation. If we do, we're going to have to, you know, adjust and deal with it. We might have to do some trenching and some sand and some cover over. But to get a proper permit to install a new septic facility that the size that they're proposing, a sewage treatment plant, the size they're proposing, is going to take this level of permitting.
How often in communication are they?
They've been actually really good. Unfortunately, the lead engineer was on vacation for a week, so for a couple days there, I thought I was getting ignored, and then I realized he was on vacation. He called me the day he returned. So I'd consider that a pretty appropriate level of communication.
All right.
Thank you.
Are you ready? Thank you, Lisa.
Are you ready for Grady?
Yes. Put the rest of it on hold. We're going to, who's here for us?
Grady?
Grady, Grady Consulting.
Yep.
We're looking for a local variance on Grove Street. Yes, they're out.
Oh.
It's really up to you. Pay attention. You want to be
It's a rare scenario in which you don't acquiesce to my wishes, so I thank you for that, Madam Chair.
Point taken.
Is that an audience
member? No, that it's not.
No, I know that, but that topic?
Yes.
Okay.
Yep.
Hi, how are you? Good, come on up.
Good.
We are being recorded, if you wouldn't mind introducing yourself for the viewing public.
My name is Rob Carlazon. I'm with Grady Consulting.
Okay.
I'm filling in for Kevin Grady tonight.
Okay.
He's actually in a planning board meeting.
Rob?
Yep, Rob.
Engineer?
Engineer in training.
Engineer in training.
Correct.
Okay.
Yep.
Wonderful.
Yep. Pretty good.
Welcome.
We'll be easy on you. Okay. <laughs> All right. What do you got here? This is... Yeah, we've got this plan here too. Yeah, yeah, okay. Yep. This is... We'll follow along with you. Yep. This is a septic system repair at 3 Grove Street. Right now it's an existing single family dwelling.
Mm-hmm.
There's an existing leaching field out the side yard, existing septic tank out in the back. There are wetlands out in the backyard. We meet all the setback requirements to wetlands. Proposed work, we have a proposed 1,500 gallon septic tank, 1,500 gallon pump chamber, and the, it's a 36.17 foot long by 26.5 foot wide by 13 inch deep. Leaching field with ADS arc 36 biodiffusers. We're here today, we're asking for two local upgrades. I'll start with the second one. We had to use a sieve analysis. Unable to do a perk test because there was quite a bit of fill. We had 84 inches of fill. Organic layer. So a perk test was not possible. We're also asking for a 1 foot separation to the bottom of the leaching system.
Mm-hmm.
We had groundwater pretty high, where was it? At 2 foot 10 inches, which is very high,
mm-hmm.
but not surprising in this neighborhood.
Mm-hmm.
And especially with the proximity to wetlands.
Mm-hmm.
I think that's...
Yeah, that's all we have listed here,
yeah.
These two.
Yep.
So there had to be a sieve done because you couldn't perform a perk.
Correct.
And then you want to SAS from 4 feet to 3 feet. How many bedrooms is this?
It's a 3-bedroom.
Okay.
So there's an existing septic, same leaching field?
Yep, kind of in a similar area. It's really the only place for the leaching field itself.
Just gonna roll around.
Mm-hmm. Does this have a membrane?
Thank
is
you,
what
ma'am.
Barry's asking.
Yes, yeah. There should be. I think it's all the way around.
Yep.
Yeah, the pollen barrier.
Yep, the pollen barrier.
Yep.
Okay, so do we need a deed restriction at all?
Yep, I believe that is listed on here, right below the local upgrade approval section. It's simple. And, I think it explains it.
The system.
So the home is currently occupied?
I believe. I don't believe it's occupied right now. I think it was an older man passed away.
Okay.
I think the daughter or son is just handling or selling it.
Okay. Taking care of the estate.
Yep.
Okay. I don't think I have any questions.
Okay. I'd like to make a motion to accept the two variances as presented by Grady Consulting on 3 Grove Street.
Second. All in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Thank you.
Thank you.
Come back again.
Thanks, Rob.
All right. Thank you, guys.
You're welcome.
All right.
All right. Lisa's
yes,
second outbreak. We already did you get the second in?
Yes, we got the
motion. Okay, perfect. How about the home code violation?
For Oldham?
Yeah.
A letter was sent. I called, sent emails. I received back an empty email, and there was a call on the history, recorded on the phone here, but no voice message, no actual response. I sent out a second set of emails, a second set of phone calls, received no response to those, and sent out a final email saying you are now receiving a registered letter. The registered letter went out late last week after
mm-hmm.
communication established back and forth.
Okay. And we have a copy of that letter?
Yes.
Yes.
Yeah. Okay. Tentatively, the 27th would be the time to take that up to allow the owner some amount of time to respond.
So if we can make sure that hits the agenda
yes.
as a line item for, and as well as we'll update the outbreaks as they continue. Activity here at the Board of Health
remains high.
Great.
I don't know why, because there's nothing left to buy out there. Anything that was left to buy, people have bought.
Mm-hmm.
Anything left for sale is being avidly fought over. So.
And everything that has been invented has already been invented, which was said in the 1800s. So you never know.
Mm-hmm. Don't know about that. I don't know nothing about that. But I do know that real estate remains very, very tight market in this town. And the good news for us is, though, that the vacant homes and vacant lots are continuing to move rather quickly because of it, which is good for the town.
Perfect. Okay, 13 points of interest pertaining to the local regulation upgrades. I think I would, what do you want to do?
I'm going to make a motion to table that. It seems the last few several meetings we've got involved in some other projects. So
correct.
I hope that won't be tabled forever, but we. Yeah. I don't think.
Let's put it back. Let's put it on for the 27th.
Who's making the motion?
Gary's making the motion. I will second it. All in favor?
Aye. Aye.
Okay, we're going to go on to the T21 checklist. We were each given a checklist that Cheryl Sabara was kind enough to send out to us. We had 1 to 22. Basically, yes or no answers. I believe we have all filled out.
No. Matt, and I made this point earlier in the week to
me.
To Sheila.
Mm-hmm.
I was present at the meeting when Cheryl was here and gave us the checklist.
Mm-hmm.
I certainly didn't walk away with the feeling that we were all asked to go home, so to speak, and fill it out. I mean, I think this is a big change going from 18 to 21, and I felt it merited some discussion. I made some choices at home,
mm-hmm.
and I think we can discuss them, but there's some of the bullet points I would probably want to get some clarification from the health agent. Now, I know one of our board members is on vacation.
Mm-hmm.
She went home and filled it out so her wishes could be present.
Correct.
But I think, you know.
So you are not prepared to go over
I'm fully prepared to go over it, but I.
Not go over it, but to actually come up with the final numbers.
Absolutely. Absolutely. But I think they merit discussion.
Okay. Would you like to. Which ones would you like to discuss?
If the ones that I voted on, if you want to just vote on them, that would be fine. If that's
well, are there ones that if we'd like to discuss, I mean, we might as well discuss. Mrs. McSweeney was fully aware that we wanted to have this document filled out before she left on vacation, which she complied to.
And that's her.
And this is her signed copy.
Okay.
And it was received on the 2nd. I have mine.
And I have mine as
okay.
well.
Okay. If what I think, while we've got the camera and we've got other people here, let's discuss.
Yeah, well, we can go right down the list and on the votes, and I have a few that I had questions on.
Okay.
So if you want to do that.
All right. So to make this all. Yeah, for transparency, do you want to take the roll call on the numbers you have?
I have a copy of
you
don't
have
like
Mrs. McSweeney's.
I gave it to you, right?
Okay. What I think might be better is somebody other than me reads this, her response to those. That way there's no question, because we all trust you.
Uh-oh.
I don't trust her.
You don't trust her?
I don't
trust her. Either.
Oh. Did you sign in?
No, I wrote his name.
And who is here? Would you like to introduce yourself?
No, she signed in. She can say.
I
do trust her.
We are being recorded, so.
Yeah, I
know. Yeah. WATD is in the house.
Yes.
Yes.
Correct.
And this woman was here last meeting.
Yes. My name's Anna Betancourt. I'm with Clerk Enterprises.
Yes. Okay. And you are here with this discussion that we're going to take tonight?
That is my point of interest, yes.
Yes, perfect. Well, welcome. Thank
and,
you.
And
for coming.
Forgive me, I heard you represent.
Verk Enterprises. It's the community.
No.
Yep.
All right, so for those viewing this at home, the regulation restricting the sale of tobacco products is what the board is taking up at this point. There is a checklist of 22 items which have a response of yes or no. So they're a guideline for the board to be able to kind of craft what we in Pembroke would like it to look like. We did the same thing when Gary had brought forth the e-cigarette ruling and the change in the age. We are looking to raise the tobacco age to 21, the sale of tobacco. We're now going to fine-tune it. So the first question, definition of tobacco products, including nicotine delivery products. I voted yes, that I would like it to include the definition nicotine delivery products.
I also voted yes, Madam Chair.
And Gail has voted yes.
Okay, so that is unanimous.
I'm gonna log them here, okay?
Perfect, yes. Number two, include sensation sign requirements. I voted no.
I voted no, Madam Chair.
And Gail voted yes.
Okay, so the noes have it. Number three, include minimum cigar package size and price. I voted no.
I also voted no, Madam Chair. Did you look at my list before we...
No, I did not, Ms. Devine. And
Gail on number three voted no.
Okay, so there's that's unanimous. Number four, no permit renewal if outstanding fines exist. I voted yes.
I also voted yes. Pretty good.
And Gail voted yes.
Perfect, unanimous. Number five, no permit renewal if three sales to under MLSA. On that one, I voted yes.
I also voted yes.
And Gail voted yes.
Okay, three for three.
I have on number six. Lisa, would you care to elaborate, cap or reduce the number of permits? That was kind of, it felt a little vague to me. I don't know if it was
cigarette sales is a separate permit handled under our food permits to cap the number of tobacco sales licenses would be to say you're only going to allow X number of businesses within the community. So if you reach that cap and someone wanted to come in and open a convenience store or a tobacco store and was going to sell tobacco, that they would be told no, there would be a limit to the number of establishments allowed to sell.
I wasn't clear on that. Thank you. I wasn't clear on that one because there was no number associated with it. So I didn't know.
Right.
I mean,
kind of similar to a liquor. What we presently have for liquor, there's just so many liquor licenses out there.
That is correct.
Okay.
So
do you want to, it's asking us if we want to cap it or reduce the, any type of an establishment if in the future of being able to sell a tobacco.
I would remind the board that if they want to do any further research on any of these items, you can always table a question. You don't have to answer every question tonight.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
If this leads to more
table
discussion.
Table six?
That would be my view. I left that one open on my list.
Well, I have an answer. I'm sure Gail has an answer, but out of respect, let's table number six. And then you can check a little bit further into that one. Number seven is no sales within 500 feet of a school. I said yes.
I also said yes.
And Gil said yes.
Okay, three has it. Number eight is no new permits within blank feet of an existing permit. There is no number of footage there, but I stated no in regards to not allowing side-by-side commerce. I said no.
I left that one blank. I felt that to vote on that one, I would want a number of, I would want the board to establish a number of feet, at least before I would cast my vote.
Okay. Well, table number eight.
We don't have to.
Well, no, I want to give you this, like you said when we started this is important. When I was looking at this question, I thought about Cumberland Farms and 7-Eleven. Those are two next, pretty much within 100 feet, maybe.
Give or take, probably.
Give or take, yeah. Or less than. So I didn't want to restrict that from happening.
Well, you could grandfather any previously existing proximity issues, but that's not your only one. Consider all the mobile marts and everything else up on 139. You literally have on 139, adjacent to Route 3, four different gas service stations literally on every corner, and they all sell. So that's not the only circumstance and where it would happen.
Okay. Do you still want to table it?
I mean, there are two.
There's another one. Yep.
Yeah.
Well, let's see what I'm going to say. I have said no.
Gail has said no.
Okay. No. Yep. No has it.
Okay. So.
Only number six at this point.
So if number eight is a no, then within how many feet is the
is irrelevant.
You're right. It's not relevant as a no.
Okay. No restriction.
We have it with the school, but we're not having it for any other
in-between establishments.
Okay, fair enough.
Okay. Number nine, restrict flavored tobacco products. I have voted no.
I vote a resounding no.
And Gail, no.
No's have it. Minimum legal age for tobacco products is number 10. Our choices are 18 or 21. I voted 21.
Again, a resounding 21.
And Gail was 21.
Okay, so that one's done. Number 11, ban blunt wraps. I have voted no.
I voted no.
Gail voted yes.
Okay, no's have it. 12, ban free distribution of tobacco products and redemption coupons. I choose yes to ban them.
I chose no. I chose no because it included the redemption of coupons. While banning free distribution of tobacco products, I could have gone yes in there, but unless I misunderstood, I felt that, you know, if there are coupons, you know, if somebody received them from wherever, they should be able to redeem them. So if number 12 was written as it is, I voted no.
Okay.
And Gail voted yes.
Okay. Yes has it. 13, ban out of package sales. I voted no.
I voted no.
She voted yes.
Okay, no's have it. 14, ban self-service displays. This one,
keep in mind we already have it in place that in an establishment that allows people under the age of the legal age to purchase is the way we've already stated it. They may not have self-service displays, so right now the only stores in Pembroke that have what would be considered, and on my inspection, it really isn't what I'd call a self-service display, but it's a display where someone could gain some amount of access directly to a tobacco product, are stores that already restrict the age to 18 and up to even come in their establishment, such as some of the vape shops and the tobacco-only shops. None of our supermarkets or convenience stores have any access directly to the tobacco product by the consumer. So that one, we're kind of doing it already, but if you wanted to do this, that's not a problem. Obviously, it's up to the board, but you would only be affecting, I think, four shops, maybe even less.
Right, and when I took my own little field trip, just because I haven't been in a smoke shop quite some time. To me, the displays that were like for Brennan's, when I walked into Brennan's, I truly saw a tobacco establishment. There was a lot of different displays and different, you know, they could take a little bit of this and a little bit of that and
well, some of the places allow their own blending, and I can see the appeal of that. If someone's more of a connoisseur of tobacco, I can see where someone would want to fabricate their own blend or flavor by doing so.
Right. So with that already set up in the way that it was shown with the minimal amount of glass products within the shop, I actually vote no on 14.
I also voted no.
And Gail voted yes.
So no, right? No's have it. 15 is to ban vending machines. Yes.
Yes.
And Gail voted yes.
Okay. 16 is to ban non-residential roll your own. Again, we have an acronym, YRYO machines. I have said no.
I said no as well.
Gail said yes.
Okay, no's have it. 17, ban tobacco product sales in healthcare institutions. Emphatically, yes.
You said yes?
Yes.
I said no.
Okay.
Gail said no.
Okay. So the no's have it. Ban product sales in educational institutions.
Yes.
I I'm say sorry. Yes.
Gail said yes.
Okay, so the yeses have it. Fining structure mirrors the state law or a flat line. We had 100, 200 to 300. We have 300 across the board. I have the fining structure for 19 as 100, 200, 300.
As did I, 100, 200, 300.
Thank you. So that's
a yes. 20. Tolling periods for violations. Answers are 24 months or 36 months. I have 24 months.
I have 36 months.
Gail has 24.
Okay, 24 months it is. 21 is the suspension period. Maintain or double lengths. 7 to 30 days or 14 to 60 days. I have 7 to 30 days suspension period.
I did not vote on that particular one. Can you say a little bit more on that, Lisa? On the suspension period, maintain or double the lengths?
It basically says if an establishment was found in violation that was significant enough to require suspension, do you want to stay with the current state suspension rate, or do you want to have a longer one?
So we currently have 7 and 30. That's
correct.
Okay.
Do you want to double it?
And what was your vote?
Mine is 7 to 30.
Mine is also
just
7 to 30.
Same.
Yep.
Gail is
7
to 30.
Okay.
I'm sorry. 14, 60.
So 7 to 30 days it is.
The only other thing as we go through this, I'd remind the board, keep in mind you can establish any regulations you'd like. For some reason, if you find some aspect of these not working, there's no statute or rule that says you can't go back and revisit. For example, let's say everyone's in perfect compliance, wonderful, the 7 and 30 works, but if you were to go 6 months into this program and find that certain people are constantly out of compliance, you could revisit and change those constrictions at that time.
Correct. Thank you, Lisa.
No problem.
22. Love this terminology. Shall versus may. Language for suspensions. I've actually picked may.
I also went with may.
And Gail picked shall.
May has it. It's an interpretation. Okay. So with the exception of item number 6.
And, you know, two of the board members have voted 6. I mean, I didn't vote, not that I officially abstained, but I'm happy to, you know.
Okay, then if you don't, that's fine. My vote on number 6, which was cap or reduce number of permits, I voted no.
And Gail voted no.
Okay, so the no's have it.
Excellent.
So, we have been able, which I'm very happy about, is to come up with this checklist now with the total numbers, items number 1 through 22, how we have voted, all three sitting board members, to now send that off to Cheryl Sabara so that Cheryl is writing that up for us.
Yep, and then she will come to your next meeting, go over it with you, talk about implementation, the amount of time you're going to give for implementation, how you're going to publicize the implementation.
In the language of when,
Okay.
You know,
obviously you wouldn't vote this, or you can. It would be difficult to expect a retailer to come into instant compliance, there has to be some amount of public education. There has to be some amount of time to educate the employees, and conversely, to educate their regular consumers so that they understand that if any of these changes are going to affect their regular consumers, that they have time to let their consumers know too.
Okay. You know, Madam Chair, we've spent a considerable amount of time on this. Is what we'll call T21.
Mm-hmm.
You know, I certainly think that all 22 of these are important and merited discussion. You know, clearly going to T21, and quite frankly, I was somewhat surprised that in the number of weeks that we discussed this, we really didn't have much of a public debate with respect to keeping it to 18.
I was surprised at that.
What I do recognize is that we had a lot of members from the business community that spoke about the banning of flavors versus not banning it, and you know, I heard our business community loud and clear, and I hope that Pembroke will successfully incorporate all of these bullet points that we voted on.
Mm-hmm.
I look forward to moving forward.
And as having been someone here, and you know, I don't have you on the agenda, but you have come back as a interest in a store selling tobacco. Do you have any further opinions? What do you think of this list?
At the company, Burke, we operate all the way from Plymouth to Andover, Massachusetts, and stores in New Hampshire, so I'm well-versed in the laws and regulations and different pending regulations in Massachusetts, and I feel that there was a good decision made in the sense where if the legal tobacco purchase age is 21, it takes some of the other things out of it as mm-hmm. far as flavors, because if you are 21, then you should be able to choose the flavor or pricing. I mean, we could go into the reasons, but I spoke at the last hearing.
Mm-hmm.
Typically, on the age 21, I've seen towns do different things in, as far as time, but as a retailer, typically 60 days is more than enough. We just need to know to tell mm-hmm. our staff, because again, we operate in several towns throughout Massachusetts, and we have them as 21 and 18. We just let our people know, and whatever date, you know, say you said May 1st,
mm-hmm.
we remind the store before, train our managers and our staff, and we're always reminding the day before.
Okay.
So whatever you choose, we're more than happy to comply with and work with you.
Okay. So 60 days.
When all is said and done, I hope that this will help in keeping it out of the high schools and some of our younger kids.
I hope, but you know, they're very resourceful. But I think I think that it's an important health issue, professionally as well as personally. So with that being said, we are going to move on to new business. Gary, I think you are going to, we have the response to the open meeting law violation.
Yeah, I received a copy. I believe you have a mm-hmm. copy as well, Madam Chair.
Yeah, so if you just want to present, thank you for coming in.
Thank you.
Thank you, ma'am.
Stay warm.
Yes.
Stay safe.
Keep that
everyone.
Shovel. Stay safe. Okay, so on to their response. We have a copy of it?
Yeah, I've got a copy of the resolution, perhaps, from the Division of Open Government, and they have sent a letter to all parties involved stating that the open meeting law, unless we hear from the person who filed the complaint, which was our health agent, Ms. Cullity, unless the board hears from her in the next 30 days, they will consider that whatever steps the board has decided to have situations like this not occur in the future, we will move forward.
Okay. All right, so we will wait to see what that decision comes out as. But we have the Attorney General's letter.
Yeah.
If we can just keep that, like the previous one, we're just keeping, I want a beginning and I want an end, so we know that it is done and over with. We're going to go on to animal inspector. We have animal inspector needs to be nominated before the end of March, and then into the state beginning of April.
Not the beginning of April, April 1st. It has to be in, or we face a $500 fine.
Now, who is requiring that we have to have that by April 1?
State Division of Animal Inspection.
Currently, right now, I believe you hold
yes. The
animal inspector.
Correct. I do not have a burning desire to remain as such, let me be clear. However, when Mimi Crowley could no longer keep performing the job, no one else wanted to perform the job, and the job has to be filled. By state requirement, someone has to do it. So my thoughts are this. Now, I've served all this time, and I am more than happy to give it up. However, in my inspections as I go around town, I try to find someone else. They would be interested in doing this. Most people at most barns are busy enough. They have no interest in doing this. I thought I had found a gentleman. They have a farm down on School Street. He came in and talked to me, learned a little bit more about the job, and upon learning any more about the job, was then not interested. Withdrew his interest, we'll say kindly. I'm now working on one more person that I think might be interested. The one thing the board could consider doing is putting out an advertisement for it. It requires all quarantines with follow-up documentation to be sent to the state, as well as a barn book, they call it, a barn inspection once a year. It's a very simple little checklist, and that to be sent into the state once a year. The problem, it pays $6,000 for the whole year, which works out to about $100 a week. It is very difficult to get someone to be interested, to be called out. You know, you don't have to do it in a moment's notice, but, you know, within, say, a 24-hour period to go out and do a quarantine and then go back and make sure the animal is safe. And as well as in the fall, every fall, to do, I don't know, about 75 barn inspections, because it includes chickens, too. It's not just horses and cows, it's chickens. Believe it or not, our horse farms are maybe you probably do believe it, actually. You're in real estate. Our horse farms are dropping off very, very, very quickly. The popularity of keeping horses, even backyard horses, has dropped off dramatically, especially in Pembroke, in the last 5 years. However, that is countered by the number of people that all want to keep chickens. So there's more stops, but they're much quicker. Inspecting a flock of 6 chickens is very little work, and as opposed to, for example, Riverwind Farm, you know, with 30 or 40 horses at it. So. But we could consider going on a public search. The board might want to turn in my name just to meet the quote-unquote deadline of April 1st. But there's nothing that says the board can't, you know, if someone else is found suitable, then send in another form where we're transferring duties or anything else to another individual.
So anyone who has chickens?
Yes.
In town needs to...
Inspected once a year, yes.
Has to, 2?
2 chickens.
6?
6.
10, they have 24. To hold a permit?
They have to hold a permit no matter how many chickens. There's just no fee.
There's no fee.
Up until 10.
Up until 10, they're free. In other words, if you have like a pet flock, the idea thinking back then, we may have to change that though, because there's people unfortunately that are choosing to take advantage of that. I only have 10 chickens, so it's free, and I get out there and there's 20 chickens.
Mm-hmm.
Oh, well, we got some chicks. Well, yes, I understand, but still. So we may have to change that to even, you know, just a few birds, just a lower fee, of course. That's up to the discretion of the board. But again, for the sum of $100 a week, it's very difficult to find someone willing to do that work. But we can certainly put out an advertisement and try.
How long have you held the position?
5 years. The other thing is, remember, it's easy to say, oh, okay, hey, do you want a job? But someone has to be knowledgeable about animal husbandry, what's normal. Someone who does not know their livestock could easily walk up on a situation and misinterpret it. For example, there are people that think someone's abusing their birds because they don't understand there is such a breed of bird as naked-necked chickens. They are a real breed. Mm-hmm. Yes, they look frightening, not unlike the hairless cats. They look a little strange. And someone has to understand what looks normal for livestock and what doesn't look normal for livestock. Also, people think, oh, this is a great job for animal lovers. I will lead off with, this is not a job for someone with a weak stomach that just loves animals. Some of the situations I'm forced to face, along with the dog officer, are not fun. They're not pretty. And they are graphic. We'll leave it there.
Mm-hmm.
So this is not necessarily for someone that just wants to, you know, hug puppies and kittens. There are some significant downsides to this particular job.
Sure.
A dog attack is one of the most brutal things you will ever learn about. We've had two, actually I take that back, we've had three pretty severe dog attacks in my tenure, two of which ended up in court. One of them was very, very graphic.
Mm-hmm.
And I was involved very much with the investigation with the dog officer about that. That was a very heart-rending case.
Are you looking to give this position up?
It's the will of the board. I mean, yes, to a certain degree, yes, this is a lot of work. But that's therein the problem lies. It's a lot of work for a very small amount of compensation.
Mm-hmm.
And therein lies the problem. However, I don't know, maybe there is someone out there that just a small part-time job would be great and wonderful for them. For example, someone who's already on a retirement package that can only earn so much money every year,
mm-hmm.
In which a large stipend would not work for someone like that because it would affect maybe, I don't know, some sort of benefit package they might receive. Obviously, someone with a disability, I'm not saying I'm prejudiced against anyone disabled, but you must be able to walk a farm.
Mm-hmm.
You have to be able to walk out to where cows are. You must be able to walk out to where horses are. You must be able to get to the animals to look at them. So someone with a mobility challenge might not be able to execute the job.
You may have at one point taken this position by default.
Very much by default.
Right, but I'm going
to... I never solicited for it. No, that would be true. It came to me by default, by Mamie stepping down, by no one else stepping up, is how this landed here.
And I'm not insinuating that you've lost your passion for it. That's not for me to say.
I've not lost my passion for it. I love animals, and anyone who knows me knows I've been in animals of all kinds for several years, including my Morgan show horses and things of that nature. The reality is there's so many hours in a day. And the job of health agent has gotten so large and so overwhelming that, yes, I would say there is a challenge to complete both tasks well.
So if you had your druthers, if we found a
qualified... If we found a great person, that would be wonderful.
But if we didn't, you would be...
If we cannot find someone capable and willing to do it for the stipend, yes, somebody must do it. It can't be undone.
I would do it if I must,
but I would prefer... I prefer to find another Mimi Crowley, is what I would really prefer. Wildly knowledgeable about animals, very thorough, very meticulous lady. She took a wonderful job in downtown Boston, God bless her, but you can imagine, anyone working 40 hours a week... You know, somewhere with a commute. This is just too much work, and again, the compensation is too low to interest them.
I know you spoke to a gentleman who has maybe withdrawn his interest. Do you have a person that you have some? Do you have someone in mind?
I have one other individual that I am trying to reach out to see if they have some interest. That is very knowledgeable about livestock and farming in the community.
We could put an ad in, or we could wait and find out what...
We can absolutely put an ad in.
Right.
But remember, a name must go into the state. You only have one...
Right, and we only have
you
one...
You have
more...
to... If you don't want to make a decision tonight, I'm totally cool with that. A decision has to be rendered and voted on by this night to make the state's deadline. There's no ifs, ands, or buts. There's no way we're going to get an ad run,
right,
people back, and get a chance to see them.
Well, I think that it only makes sense, number one... I would like to make a motion and nominate Lisa Cullity as the animal inspector while we search for a possibility of someone out there who would like to...
And if they're watching,
come in. And if you're watching, please call... The town hall, we are closed tomorrow because of a snowstorm. But reach out to me, reach out to Gary or Lisa. But I think that only makes sense. I do not want to wait until the 27th. The reason being is that if we wait and something comes up, I do not want this town to be hit with a violation of $500 for not having that paperwork in.
Do you want me to get the state's draft regs, the state's draft job description, and put that before the board so that, hear me out, so that the board can decide, hey, I want to run this ad. Not only that, between those 2 weeks, I'll talk to that last individual that I thought may
mm-hmm.
be interested. But why don't I try to have that prepared for then so the board, if they like that, we could actually go ahead and get that in the paper and get the ball rolling.
Okay, that sounds like a good idea. I actually spent time preparing for the meeting. I pulled up the inspector's qualifications and duties off the Massachusetts
That's
website.
Exactly
that.
Yep.
And it basically is the qualifications and the duties. I also had a conversation with Michael Cahill, and thank you for taking my call today in regards to this. So I am looking for a second for my nomination for the interim, and we will look at this document, which I can actually leave with Lisa, with
Chilla,
dear.
Can maybe go on camera?
You can go on camera.
You could say.
Yeah.
I will second your motion, Madam Chair.
All in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Okay.
And by all means, in your travels, if either of you come across someone that might fit the mold.
So in the interim, I'll congratulate you on your reappointment.
No, condolences. Condolences.
Mm-hmm. Okay, moving right along. One of our attachments was the vacation schedule. Okay. This is something we've done for the last several. We've done this since I've been here.
Obviously, with my tenure with the town, I'm entitled to 3 weeks of vacation a year. Ms. Landy, of course, is entitled to vacation. So what we did is we sat down, we went over all of our vacation schedules. We made sure neither of us, while we'll be gone, quote unquote, back to back, we will never be gone at the same time.
Mm-hmm.
The one thing I wanted to explain to the board through no fault of my own, you'll notice I have my weeks, unfortunately, are 3 back to back, and I'll explain how that happened. I always go on one camping trip in July and one camping trip in August. I have every year, it's actually since my employment began. Right after Christmas, my cousin came to town saying hi to all the family. My cousin, for those who aren't familiar, lives in England, London, England. And dropped the bomb that over the New Year's they got engaged on Nantucket Island and are planning their wedding for July 28th, which obviously falls right in the middle of my 2 vacations. So unavoidably for me, I will end up with 3 weeks of vacation that are close together. This was not my intention to do with the town. I do have coverage in place, professional coverage, which will not cost the town anything. I apologize to the board, but there's nothing I can do about it. Obviously, I'm not going to go over to London, England for 2 days. That's ridiculous travel-wise as well as economically. And as far as my 2 vacations, for those that aren't familiar, I go to very popular campground destinations. I paid for these weeks last year because you renew for the following season. They're paid in full and they would be non-refundable. In other words, any which way I slice it, to cancel any one of these vacations would mean to miss my cousin's wedding or to give up several $100 in reservations.
No, and if we have a meeting, it only looks like it's just going to involve the July 10th. If I'm if I'm looking at this correctly, for you, I don't know if you get vacation already.
I get a day a month. Yeah. I get like 5 of them.
And Sheila, you're July, and you do not need to explain to us, but you are June 29th to July 5th.
I'm already in Chicago.
Okay, and August 25th.
Apparently, weddings
September.
Are in the air.
And that's I have a timesheet on the Cape.
Okay. Well, I don't have a problem with the schedule. I do want to ask a question, though, on this schedule as printed. Is that Shane McGlone?
Yes.
Well, okay, not Sean. Sean. Okay.
Sorry. Yeah, Shayne.
Okay. Shane McGlone. Lisa, you've got 3 dates blocked off, and you've got Arthur, Shane, and Joe Stack.
Yep.
Is each one of them covering?
They're available by phone. All of those dates, all of those gentlemen. So, in other words, it's whoever Sheila gets a hold of that responds most quickly.
So all 3 are covering, or have
any particular day that I'm gone, they're generous enough to offer their services at any of those times.
Okay. Can you provide, I could get it very easily, but could you provide the phone numbers?
Sheila has them all, but sure, yeah. Would you like to reach out to them directly?
Joe Stark, do I have them?
You certainly should. He's on the computer, but if not, I'll make sure you have his Outlook contact.
So no particular lead. All 3 of them are going to help out.
Correct.
Okay.
Well, you never know what's going to happen. You never know
right.
when you're going to pick
Arthur
up the phone. Someone could be on a perk test and Arthur might be there, or Joe might be busy in Hanover and someone else is, usually with 3 individuals, you're bound to get one that's going to be able to cover what you need to cover. Everyone knows that Joe Stack is the inspector over in Hanover?
Mm-hmm.
Okay. And obviously you know Mr. McGlone.
And in regards to any type of perk tests that have to be going on, anything closing the end of July would have already been perked here. And then August, it should already be done, and it should all fall into that week, so.
And I give all installers and engineers my mm-hmm. vacation list, so they install all over the South Shore, so most of them will simply, as any particular agent in any town is on vacation, just plan their jobs accordingly and try mm-hmm. to work in different towns. Most okay. of them do.
Okay, and I'm only going away during whenever I can scoot out of town, so it doesn't matter. I don't know if Gary has any set vacation, but we do have three members of the board, so all we need to have is two here.
Correct.
To be able to go forward with the meeting, so I'm not really concerned about that. Vacations are well-deserved. Ladies, enjoy.
Thank you.
Okay, the last thing that we have coming up is the office communication protocol. This was something that was sent out to us for us to take a look at. In order for us to continue running like a well-oiled machine with Sheila being new to the position, I think this might help make her job a little bit easier. I think she has done a phenomenal job so far.
I'll second that.
Mr. Fine, you're out of order.
Sorry.
If someone could herd cats, it would be her.
Okay. One of the things was, you know, and I jotted down all my thoughts today when I was taking a look at this. What does the board expect of me in terms of communication? I'm going to answer this from myself directly. Your terms of communication to me are excellent. I love the way that you communicate. Electronic communication is something that I personally find works very well. I know there are sometimes you have to call me and just say, geez, did you open up your email? Because I'm usually on the other one. But electronic communication, I think, is sufficient. It's working for me. I think that if any of the board members have a question, if they appear here in front of you, I think that you try and do your best to help them. I don't want to say that that's the only way I want you to communicate, is electronically. I want you to continue doing what you're doing, but I think I take precedent with some of the other issues coming down in this list. So I'm not quite sure how electronic is working with Gary. I know on a fairly regular basis, I'm in here, Gary's in here, and I know that Mrs. McSweeney is in here asking questions of you, looking for information. I say continue doing what you're doing, but I think for a board and for the documents, electronic communication is quite sufficient. I don't know if Gary has anything to add to there.
Should I pull
Sheila, could you come
yeah,
and take a
I
seat?
Think you need to
back to the interview.
Be nice.
Yes, Mr.
Fine.
Sheila, when I got this list, and I read the questions for you, but I'd like you to speak a little bit. I mean, you're fairly new in the job, mm-hmm. and although I laughed in front of the camera and was gaveled by Madam Chair, I would certainly, all kidding aside, echo the sentiments that I think your learning curve has been certainly existent, but I think you've been a very great asset to the board, me personally. So, you know, I applaud the work that you've done thus far. However, when I read the list, I got a sense you weren't asking for feedback per se. How am I doing? I sensed a little, and I don't want to put words in your mouth, Sheila, a little concern about how you can be most efficient. So I guess I don't know if we, Madam Chair, if we're going to take these one by one, or I'd like to hear, you know, kind of what was percolating in your head that made you come up with this list, if I might.
Okay, well, some people prefer to have everything in writing, so they prefer electronic, because I'm not going to actually write you a letter and mail it to your house, but, you know, electronic is in writing. Some people find it's easier that if you talk to them, because then you can, you know, one question leads to another question and back and forth. Mm-hmm. Right, so that's where the, is electronic communication enough, or do you prefer to, when something's up in the office, that I call you and say, hey, such and such is coming down, or, you know.
Do you find the fact that people might prefer different ways of communication, which, do you find it to the point of being inconsistent?
Well, for the most part, you know, electronic has been working, and if you call, obviously I'm not going to say send me an email.
Okay.
But some people prefer, I guess I want to know how you prefer to get your information.
I like to see it and touch it. When I have it in email form, I'm able to print it. I'm able to save it. I can file it away, which is what I should be doing if I'm doing the job.
And you can write on it.
Exactly. I can make notes. That's my opinion. That's how I communicate. I also can communicate very well one-on-one. But in my busy life, because I have a full-time job, I find email quite sufficient. Because I can, you send through everything. We get all the attachments that we need to look at. So I don't think that you need to do anything more. And I know this probably isn't about you and your performance. We're talking about how we can communicate better between what our needs are as a board to you being able to facilitate them to the best of your ability. One of the questions is what can you expect from members in regard to the communication of the receipt of these materials? Again, if we're all doing our job, you're doing your job, you're scanning it, you're sending it to us. I think that if we get an email, number one, we should acknowledge the receipt of that email, whether we reply directly to sender, got it, thanks a lot, or if on email there is a receipt, like if you are to send an email and I open it, you automatically know that I've opened it, so you can assume that I've gotten it.
Right, but that only works if send it to your town account.
Okay.
Comcast, I think, will do it,
mm-hmm.
You know. But if you send it to Gmail, Gmail doesn't forward that stuff along.
Okay.
And there are members that
have Gmail. Another form of that.
Yeah.
So if
everyone has a Town of Pembroke, Mass. Email available to them.
Right.
But they don't want to use some.
Correct.
For various reasons, don't want to use it.
Correct. There are members who don't want to use it and would rather it go to their personal. So I think so when I open it through my Town of Pembroke, you know that I've opened it.
Right, because it'll last you. Do you want, Sheila wants a red receipt, do you want to give it to her?
Yeah, and I always say yes, because...
So when you send an email out, I'm one, I don't use my Town of Pembroke email address. So when you send something out from Town of Pembroke to my Gmail account, you don't have the ability on the read receipt.
I know, it'll
send me back a message and say, we don't forward that.
So Sheila is doing her job and trying to be as proficient as possible, but she doesn't know if, in fact, we're receiving this information. And we have had several meetings where members have said, geez, I didn't get that, or I didn't print it. Can I get another copy? So if we're going to be doing our jobs, I think that, you know, we should let her know that we're receiving this information, if that's how we are going to communicate. And we truly need to communicate electronically due to the fact that we're a three-member board, and if I were to go to you via email, which is not okay, we now are a quorum, and now we are in open violation. So we need Sheila and or Lisa to be that middle person, but they need to know that we're getting what we want.
Can you go back to question number one for a minute? Sheila, in any way, shape, or form, were you the frequency of communication in question number one? Does it seem?
No, not at all.
Okay.
There's not a ton of emails going back and forth, or, you know, communication.
Okay. I don't know.
And I would expect questions, because sometimes when I send out, like, the agenda, there might be 10 attachments on it with all the homework of what you're supposed to look at before. And then if you're looking at it, and most of you look at it on your phone, right, and there's this little window, and you have to hit the down arrow, and it'll scroll up. So you may say, did I get everything? You know, am I seeing everything? Because your phone is limited. If you're not looking at it on a computer, you may not see. Even an Outlook on the computer, it may not show you all the attachments. You have to scroll down.
Do you open it up? Do you read her emails on your phone?
No, I do not.
I do not. I don't either.
Only because most of them...
Somebody does.
Yeah. Only because most of them have downloads, and I don't want to download all that information through my plan.
Yeah.
So, but I'm always, I have my laptop or my iPad with me, so I just do it that way.
Right.
And then the other thing comes to the terms of the paper printouts for the meeting. That first question, I don't think that you should be printing all the information. You attach it, you scan it, you print it once, you scan it, you attach it to the email. We should take the time to open it and print it so that when we're ready to take a look at what we're going to be discussing, if we truly want to be ready and proactive, then we want that information. I want to look through, I want to read it, I want to go through, make sure everything's in order. What do I have questions?
But I understand there's also a cost of, you know, I mean, you're a volunteer board. And there is a cost.
We are a volunteer
board.
Like
when you get, you know, a 30-page food regulation type thing. To have 90 sheets, because three is...
I will continue as the chair to print it, because I think that the records need to be, I need to have it at my fingertips. I think any chair should be required to have it. But I also think if it's a 30-page document, double-sided. It's ink and paper. I'd rather see us pay for the ink and paper than to see the town of Pembroke pay for it. That's my opinion.
Yeah, I'm gonna disagree with you, Madam Chair. And I would never want, I shouldn't say I would never, I like that you send out everything electronically. And I like in advance of our meetings on every other Monday to have the ability to pull something up. You know, if I can't sleep and it's 2 a.m. and I want to read something. So I think that's great. But I think...
Something that'll put you to sleep?
It'll keep me awake, actually, Sheila. I do think, and Donna, you made reference to we're a volunteer board. I think you should continue, or I'd like to see you continue to print all of that material for each board member, and we would have the ability to come in and pick up that material on a given date. So I'm not one for waste, and that may feel it for us blush that it is a waste. I, rather than looking at it as a waste, I feel that when you're emailing, that's an extra benefit for me as a board member, that I can look at something in advance. But there have been times where there has been something quite large. I know when we were looking at some of the ServSafe and some
of the
CMI, regulations.
Yeah,
so I often print everything out, but when a document is quite large, so I think we should, as board members, and I don't know what the other boards do, I would like to continue to be able to pick up the folder or know that it's there
for me.
It's like
in a folder, I know that.
Yeah,
I'm not really familiar with any other, any other boards.
Yeah. Well, I tried to implement folders, but everybody thought it was silly. Everybody had a colored folder, but that's kind of why I came up with it and labeled everyone a different color, so that information could be put in those so that they were here. So I guess what that leaves us to is the fact that if you continue to print, You do not have to print for me. I'm just telling you right now, because I'm gonna print it anyway. I'm gonna print it during the week anyway.
Well, how about?
But I think that board members should be now. Is when should, okay? When should that time be? When is reasonably? When is the last or latest time that Sheila will know that she can she has to have these materials printed?
I would look for Sheila to give us some guidance,
right?
Because
right.
So you made a motion, not the 27th. No, when was that?
Yeah,
in January.
27th. In January.
When, the attorney was here. Mm-hmm. Was that like the? You made a motion that all materials for the Monday meeting had to be in the Thursday before.
Thursday at 3:30 p.m. I believe.
I would like for that to be changed to Wednesday at 3:30.
Right,
so our materials.
Yeah, whatever you're giving me, I'm collecting stuff as we go along. As we're sitting having the meeting, we're going to put this on the agenda for next week, and I collect information, things that come in, letters from the Attorney General, whatever, and I scan them. Sometimes when they come in, that they send a copy to every board member.
Mm-hmm.
Different materials come in, then I just put it in your folder. I scan if one comes addressed to me, or if Lisa gives me a copy of hers. Because if it's addressed to you, I don't open it. If it's addressed to that Board of Health, I open it. If it's addressed to, if it's addressed to Donna, I don't open it.
So the deadline right now, per my motion, to get material for you to discuss on the following Monday had been Thursday at 3:30. You're asking, given the amount of material that you're copying, scanning, producing, you'd like that to be Wednesday?
Right, because what I want to do is if you say Wednesday, that I would have it ready by the end of the day on Thursday.
Okay.
If you want, so you call and say, I'd send out an e-copy in the morning, say Thursday morning, because it doesn't take long to scan. This is what I have. You can look at it and go, I'm going to need printouts. I need a printout of this. Some of it might be one page, maybe something you already provided. Maybe it's something you provided, so you don't need a copy of it. Right?
Mm-hmm.
So I don't necessarily have to print a complete packet for you.
Okay.
Donna's got hers all set. She's just going to do it electronically and print out what she feels she needs to print out. And Gail, I think, just needs everything printed out. I don't know what she has at home for equipment. If she goes to the library or what she does.
Mm-hmm.
So I just wanted it Wednesday so I could get it out. If it's ready to go Thursday, you can pick it up anytime after Thursday. You can pick it up Friday morning. You don't have to come here Thursday afternoon.
Wednesday is fine for me, Sheila.
Well, it's your board.
Right. Are you saying Wednesday by 3:30 that your package will be ready to be picked up before the
deadline
for adding?
The deadline for adding
is 3:30 on Wednesday, and then pickup is
Thursday afternoon at 3:30.
Thursday afternoon.
24 hours before.
By the end of Thursday, business day on Thursday, your package is available to be picked up, which will be for the meeting the Monday before.
The Monday after.
Or the Monday before.
If the meeting is on Monday, it will be ready on
Thursday.
5 days earlier, not a week and 5 days.
Correct.
Okay.
Okay, I don't have a problem with that. And the other thing is, I don't think we can put a dollar amount on how much paper, ink, and time the board is willing to use on these endeavors, because I think it's a fluctuating given any given time. I really don't think we can put a dollar amount on that.
Well,
right.
I have a question. Since you've been here, has there been an uptick in the amount of paper that you're generating?
I don't know. I have nothing to base it on. I don't know what Carol.
Since you've been here, have you noticed?
It fluctuates. I mean, when we did the, when Dr. Hartman was coming and we got all the tobacco stuff, that was a lot of, copying, because that came in as copies.
Before, yep.
That I was tracking them down saying, you got any electronic, because when you copy, it loses something.
It loses
so
a, right.
Start at
the copy of a copy is
yeah.
not a good
and
idea.
But like tonight, well, there was nothing there. Like, what was it, maybe 6 pages, 7 pages?
Very light.
Mm-hmm. And then, but the 27th, we had, there was a bunch of different things.
There was. We had the 501. Yeah. We had a lot of different things that had to be printed. But yet, my problem that I have is that these are things that we have had. I mean, that I got the same paperwork 4 months ago on the CMR 501 ruling that I still had the original copy, and I didn't need
to print it again.
Another copy, because I printed it and I filed it and I know where everything is. So, you know, it's staying organized, it's staying on top of things, but I really don't think we can put a dollar amount on this one. I just want...
It is what it is.
Right, but I also want you to feel if there is at any point in time that any endeavor that you are doing, you
can push back.
Push, lean right on into us, okay?
Variance requests.
Mm-hmm.
Do you want those when they come in?
I don't even think
that Thursday.
Honestly, and for me, I think Gary's really kind of he knows his stuff. I think Gail is still. I think it was septic for dummies.
I think that's what she said. She did.
Yeah, I think she has a book. She's new, so. It might be helpful for her to see it. I don't know about Gary. I think Gary pretty much has had everything so far, but...
I would like to see it.
You would like to see it before. Okay. I don't need to see it before.
It would be an electronic.
Right.
It would just come in and it'd say it's, you know, whatever the address is.
Right, and you can take a look at it, because we're going to be
and
having
if you
a
have
big...
Questions, then you
at
can
the meeting, I don't think that you need to make copies. I think at the meeting we have the plan in front of us. It has the variances, state and local, right there on there. And it fits very nicely on the table.
All right, so now we're down to...
Written or oral request for information. If one board member makes a written or oral request for information, currently I am providing that the information to all members. Should this policy continue? I say absolutely the policy should continue. I don't have a problem with that. I think we need to know. I think it gives us a better look.
All right, because
you can't
say to Gary, I'd like to know.
I can't.
When the weather is. So if you send it to me, then I let Gary know you're looking for it.
Exactly. And you're putting us all on it. You know, and if a person chooses to respond, just reply. They'll reply directly to you. I tend to use reply all when I want everybody to know my response. Just, you know.
All right.
Sheila.
Yes.
So currently, if one board member makes a written request or oral for information, you say currently I am providing that information to all members.
If it's information that I'm asked to compile or find.
Yeah.
Then when I have it, I send it back. I send it to all.
Okay.
It's not always the case if somebody comes in and takes a copy of something or takes something and it goes out.
Mm-hmm.
Have there been instances since you've been here where a board member has come in here and requested information and you haven't communicated that request to the other board members? So there might be, I'm just floating, there might be a little bit of inconsistency. So what I would like, if nothing
mm-hmm.
else, some consistency. So on one hand, you're saying if a board member is making a written or oral request for information, you're providing that information to all the members. I think that if we're in agreement with that, that should be consistent.
Standard protocol.
Right, but if I'm at the window
mm-hmm.
and someone makes a copy of something.
A board member.
Yes.
Donna comes in and makes a call.
And I don't know what she meant. You know, I'm at the window. I don't know what she meant.
Well, I'm not an attorney. I'm just a board member. No one on this board should be coming into this office and going into files. I think that that's dangerous, and the only reason that I say that is because due to the fact that it can be misfiled, misplaced, or damaged in any way, shape, or form.
So you're saying it all should go through Sheila?
Everything should go through Sheila. When I walk in here and I have a question, I always ask Sheila, when you have the time, can I get a copy of blah, blah, blah? When I walk through that door and I'm here outside of my job as the chairperson or on the board, just because I'm on the board doesn't mean that I can go in and pull ABC 10th Street and look at the septic design. Yes, it's public information, but these files, if that ever got put back and I wasn't paying attention, now we can't find a file. So I think that all requests, no one, and I'm really passionate about this, no board member should be allowed to come in here and freely make copies of any paperwork that is residing in this office. I think it's wrong. And I don't want to have the home be the board that has the first homeowner that comes in and we can't find their file because it's been misplaced or it was put aside somewhere and it has now gotten lost or fallen behind the cabinet or whatever. A thousand things happen. You need to be the policeman. You need to be the holder of that paperwork. Of course, Lisa can do it. But that, to me, I feel very strongly about that.
Sheila, Donna has served on the board longer than I have. I'll be completing my third year in a few months. I couldn't imagine ever coming in here and not having the courtesy of asking either you or the health agent, Lisa Cullity, to get something for me. I mean, yes, you report to us, I get that. But this, you know, you work here every day, you know where everything is, so I have never, and I couldn't imagine, I couldn't imagine in the future ever coming in here and, you know, walking right by you and opening up any one of the drawers. And I've come in here and stopped at your desk and asked for something. So I don't know if I'm as passionate as Madam Chair, but I definitely feel any for our current three members or, you know, what the board looks like 5 years from now,
mm-hmm.
it should come to whoever that administrator is.
Because
it's my responsibility.
Ultimately, it is your responsibility, and if something is misplaced or something cannot be located, you know, no, everything rolls downhill, and you're sitting at that front desk. You are wholly and 100% responsible for what's in this office. Yeah.
No, I do want to go back to...
Oh, please. Yep, go ahead.
Don't look at the clock, Madam
Chair. I am looking at the clock.
Well,
I know. I had one more question.
You shouldn't have taken so long when you were reviewing old business. I'm teasing. When the second to last question, when a board member makes a request for information, Sheila says, currently I'm providing that information to all members. I'm being serious, throwing it out for discussion. So if you make a request for something,
mm-hmm.
I'm just asking myself, would I want that answer? Would I want whatever Donna has requested? Would I want that sent to me? Or would I just want to know what a fellow board member has asked for? And I could say, you know what, Sheila, Madam Chair has asked for, you know, a copy of the plans on X, you know, X address. And I didn't really need that. She must be doing something on her own. So I'm throwing it out for discussion. I'm not against you sending it to me.
Are you talking about her other role as not a board member?
No, I think he's still, if if an email, if I sent you an email and I said, Sheila, I'm really interested in taking a look at...
food inspections for jelly donuts.
Okay. So would you turn around and then say, here's the report that you requested on jelly donuts with the CC to the other board members? I think that it's helpful information because a board member might pop up and say, what's going on with jelly donuts? You know, we've had over the last several months, there are topics that are being discussed and brought up and nobody, you know, somebody says, I didn't know about that. Well, I may have forgotten to say, geez, Sheila, can you let all the board members know about this? One perfect example was the church. The church was nowhere written, you know, it was a topic that had been brought up and some board members did not know about that. And I think it kind of keeps us all on the same page. Sure. You know, you can do anything. We're not telling board members what they can and cannot do. We're trying to, I think Sheila desperately wants to stay within the protocol. And there's no protocol. There's...
So if you make a request for some information on jelly donuts, I'm asked, cause I don't think wasn't clear to me. Are you saying we should all get that information?
I think that Sheila should say, geez, you know, so-and-so, here's the information that you wanted on jelly donuts, and send it through to everybody. And I would think that if you didn't know anything about jelly donuts, what was going on with jelly donuts, you go back to Sheila and say, what's up with jelly donuts?
Okay, so I'm fine with that.
Okay.
I was throwing out an alternative point of view.
So,
why are you saying jelly donuts?
Well, I was going to say doughboy donuts, but that...
I was just throwing out an alternative point of view. If you ask for information on a particular topic, mm-hmm. would Sheila inform the other board members that you've asked for that information? Would we want it? That's all I was...
I think her response back to me, my written communication, would be CCing all the board members.
That's fine. So you'll provide... So, I can go either way.
She's still being that police person in the middle. Because of the quorum.
Which brings us to the last one.
Yeah.
You know, compile a list of how many violations Jelly Donuts had. Or how many times Jelly Donuts was inspected.
Mm-hmm.
Or how many whatever.
Well, the first sentence in this question, is a board member allowed to redirect my daily work? Absolutely. No. Your daily work is to the health agent and the people of Pembroke who come to that window. Okay? That's all there is. If a board member is trying to redirect your daily work, no. I feel that what you should do is, if there is a project or a research that wants to be done, I think that we should come up with a request form that should be filled out, what the information is, and I think that we should keep with what the rules in the town hall are for any public records. And that is, there's a 10-day window. And I think at that point, if it is something that you feel you just are not having the time, I mean, we're really, the health agent is very busy. This office is rocking during the day.
Come in here sometime.
I do.
I know you do. That's why I
do.
Making the joke.
There are days, I'm sure, that you find it difficult to stop and even go and get lunch.
Actually, going to the bathroom is the real challenge, Sheila, I will tell you.
But I think that we should have a forms request that is filled out and that is stamp dated. And you know what? It is a request. And a request is just that.
For list statistics or whatever, Madam Chair, may I say, just to, in the interest of transparency, that if there are, and certainly there are special projects that are worthy and all these other things, that then the board decides whether or not the project is executed.
Correct.
Not a singular individual.
Mm-hmm.
Well, hold on.
Well, so how's that work though? Like say tomorrow.
Yeah.
The 14th, Gary comes in and says,
I want some information on jelly donuts. That's okay. And so,
but we, so the 10 days, we don't meet in 10 days.
Right. Right.
So then I pull?
No. Then what you do is you come back to Madam Chair and you send me an email. So-and-so is requesting this information. Then what we're going to do is we have 10 days. So I think that
we have 10 days to respond.
We have 10 days to respond, but there has to be 30 days to execute or to deliver.
But that's the public information request.
That's a public, right, but the information in this office is public record information. So 10 days, 30, and if it's a project that requires a lot of time, then we're going to have to take that up to see if we want to pay you overtime or what are we going to tell you that you don't have to do in order to accomplish that task that's being requested.
I think you just, if you would, hit the nail on the head, and this doesn't impact me as much as Sheila, but that's in where the line really begins to have a problem. It's not that Sheila and I think that you could ask most of the employees here in this town hall wouldn't do anything for everybody.
Mm-hmm.
But that's wherein the problem lies. We can't do everything for everybody. And it's always the one straw that breaks the camel's back. It's not the one project or the one request. It's the 11th or 12th that will come in and that will occur. And then suddenly it would appear as though someone hasn't accomplished X, Y, and Z on top of it.
Right.
That is my concern for Sheila. I mean, and to a degree, as the board's going to take up my job description discussion, obviously not tonight, but at another time, that's the other problem. If the board wishes for me to do all the inspections in this town as required by law, I can do them all. And many other things will have to then be removed from those obligations and descriptions because I will not be able to accomplish them all.
Mm-hmm.
And the same thing for Sheila. It's not that Sheila would tell any board member no to any request for any information or compiling or go look through things, but that takes Sheila away from all the other things. And again, no matter what we are doing, both her and I in this office, or the level of it, when someone walks in here, short of us already being on a phone assisting a citizen, mm-hmm. but a citizen walks in, a real estate agent walks in, an engineer, a banker, whomever, researching property, we then help them, and there is a finite amount of time.
Of course.
And that's the concern.
Are you suggesting, Madam Chair, that any and all requests made by the three board members to our administrator get logged in, so nothing is done with them, they get logged in, and then this log, if you will, would be presented to the board?
Mm-hmm.
Okay.
No, so I think
there's a difference. Can I point out, there's a difference between, hey, what's up with XYZ property,
right,
a singular, mm-hmm. to Sheila, go compile me a list of everyone who makes, serves, or sells jelly donuts. That's now a research project. She needs to go to the food file, go through several files, go back and type an Excel spreadsheet. This one makes them. This one just sells them. This one's a manufacturing only. And, you know, you make the joke, jelly donuts.
Mm-hmm.
I'll give a bonus point. I'll give a bonus point to the board members who can tell me how many donut suppliers there are in Pembroke and how many manufacturers.
Does that include Crellers?
It does include Crellers. Crellers are classified as donuts. Do you know?
Point of order. We could go off and
but that's
and
my point. There's
exactly.
a big difference between
exactly.
what's up with Dunkin' Donuts on Church Street
right.
to how many Dunkin's, the amount
right.
of work that goes into that. One is a simple, they're fine. They just passed an inspection. The other one requires research and everything else.
Project of research, I think, needs to be filled out by on a form. I think that the board needs to keep protocol of 10 days in, 30 days out. And I think that if it is any type of a, because the next thing we're going to, you know, I would like to have on our agenda at some point, wells. Well, there's going to be some research that's going to go on in regards to wells in the town of Pembroke. So I think that we need to allow her allocated time that the town of Pembroke pays her is to take care of the public. She will, any other projects, you know, I think we have to approve, especially if it's going to be more than an hour spent or 45 minutes spent or a half hour. I mean, we have to have a limit.
So are you in favor of something of the following? If a board member makes a request of our administrator, we'll leave it up to the expertise of the administrator if she can put it together in, you know, 15 or 20 minutes, or if she says, you know what, this feels like a project to me, I'm going to log it in, and it will be presented at our next board meeting.
I completely agree with that.
Okay.
That sounds like a motion.
Well, I would support something like that rather than
I would second that.
Can you say the motion again, Gary?
I didn't realize that I was making a motion.
But it was a beautiful one.
Yeah, I guess I would make a motion to entrust our administrator to determine if a
Give me a pay grade?
No.
Oh, you shouldn't have interrupted me when I was on a roll here in front of the camera. I'd like to make a motion for any future requests made by our administrator to allow you the ability to determine if it is something that requires extensive research, and at which point you will log it in and present that research request to the board. Clearly, the spirit here is to not dissuade any board members for asking for information. That would be a 5 or 10 minute gathering.
Mm-hmm. And I'm going to second that, but I'm also going to make a motion. I'm going to try and recap this list as best I can. I think that you can continue to communicate via electronic communication, but I think that out of courtesy, we need to reply to you if anyone has Gmail, and I think that includes you and the other board member, that thank you, I've received the attached documentation. We're going to state that all printouts,
Supplemental material
has to be in by Wednesday at 3:30 for pickup in our envelopes by Thursday at 3:30. I'd like to go further. There may be an instance where a board member may forget to bring their package with them to the Monday night meeting. We will be able to make copies. But I'd like to get into the fact that if we're going to pick up our paperwork, then leave it in your car and bring it in on Monday evening at the next meeting. We really, we're going to allow endeavors for you to take on, but there must be a Gary's motion that we're going to go with.
At my discretion.
At your discretion. And then if any board member makes or requests for information, continue as you have been doing. Do I hear a second?
I'll second that motion.
All in favor?
Aye.
Thank you.
Motion to adjourn?
I'd like to make a motion to adjourn. It is 8:18.
Second.
All in favor?
Aye.